Hello and welcome. This is Bruce Fulton, Digital Projects Librarian, University of Arizona, School of Information Resources and Library Science. Today I'm going to give a very brief overview of some of the XML metadata standards for digital resources. These are metadata standards that are used by different communities of users, libraries included, but also museums, archives, publishing, and so on. And these really go beyond MARC. I'm going to assume that you know a little bit about MARC anyway, machine-readable cataloging. MARC has been the encoding standard for bibliographic metadata for about 40 years, really since we started moving bibliographic information off of card catalogs, paper card catalogs, and onto computers. And so it's been a mainstay in the library world, but today digital resources are kind of straining the ability of MARC to describe them, and so a number of metadata standards have been developed, both for libraries and for the other communities of users that I mentioned, and we're going to talk a little bit about those today, what they look like, what they are, and why they've been developed. So we're going to talk a little bit about going beyond MARC, you know, what the issues are with MARC, and then I'm going to talk about some XML basics. This is going to be fairly non-technical, but you do need to know at least what it looks like, a little bit about how it's structured, so you can understand what these different kinds of metadata standards look like. Then I'm going to talk about half a dozen or so current XML metadata standards, call it the XML metadata zoo, and give you some examples in different communities of practice to show you how those metadata standards actually facilitate data exchange. And then we're going to finish up with just a very, very brief look at resource description framework, ontologies, the linked data movement, and how all those relate to, you may have heard the term semantic web. And so that's our agenda for today. So in 2002, Roy Tennant wrote an article for Library Journal, MARC Must Die. And I think that's probably a little bit over the top. MARC doesn't necessarily have to die. But on the other hand, it has been a little bit problematic as new digital resources have come online. So let's talk a little bit about that. MARC is a proprietary encoding standard. It's used only by the library community. So anything that's going to any kind of machine application, computer application that's going to deal with MARC has to be written specifically for the MARC standard. MARC is not a web standard. It doesn't play well with others. It doesn't work with standard tools that we use today for data development, display, interchange, and so on. It's extensible, but only with difficulty. It's not easy to extend it. So while there have been some efforts to bring MARC up to date in order to deal with digital objects, the digital resources have really outpaced the ability of MARC to keep up with the needs. Digital resources require new approaches to resource discovery and retrieval. A lot of them are out on the web. They're not easily controlled within the confines of a well-configured OPAC. And so we need different tools, different methods of data exchange to kind of collect all this information and manage it over a web. And the final issue is that other communities of users have different information needs. And so an archivist or a museum or a publishing company doesn't necessarily need all of the same kind of information that a library needs for their bibliographic records. They have unique needs. They have needs for different kinds of information. And they have needs of different ways of moving that information around and sharing it among institutions and applications. So XML to the rescue. XML is an encoding standard like MARC, which means that it's a tool that describes how you need to arrange information in it in order to exchange it. The quote here from Roy Tennant again is that when the only tool you own is a hammer, everything begins to look like a nail. And once you understand XML, You'll be seeing nails everywhere, and I think that's probably true. Really, XML is a nearly universal standard for the exchange of data today on the web and in electronic and digital communication. So what is it? I mentioned that it's an encoding standard, and it's an encoding standard designed specifically to transport and store data. It's extensible by design. The X in XML stands for extensible markup language. So it's very easy to manipulate, to change, to adapt for different needs, different communities of practice. It has a familiar syntax. Most people are familiar with HTML, which is a subset of SGML. So we have our familiar elements and attributes, and we'll take a look at those examples of those in a second here. It's open and interoperable. It's a recommended web standard. And so today, XML is used to encode metadata standards. The metadata standards themselves are defined in ways that we'll talk about shortly. So XML is an encoding mechanism. And it's used to encode metadata standards that we have in play now, the ones that we'll be talking about today. And it's also used to encode new knowledge standards, such as the resource description framework, web ontology languages, and these all are building the semantic web, which we'll go over at the end of the talk today. So XML basics, it uses tags, elements, and attributes like HTML. None of the tags are predefined. All tags are user-defined, unlike HTML. HTML tags are instructions to render things certain ways. So there's a set of predefined HTML tags. You've got, B for boldface, I for italics, H1 through H6 are your different levels of heading and so on. But in XML, the tags delineate data. They don't say anything about the display. When you open up an XML file, browsers understand it well enough to display the XML data, but there are no visual display information contained within an XML document. And the XML documents are have a hierarchical structure, which makes it suitable for describing data in a hierarchical fashion. And we're going to look at an example of that in just a second. Basically, all XML documents have a root element, a parent element, and sub-elements, which are child elements. So this allows you to arrange data in a hierarchical list and organize it. So an example here, you can see at the top, HTML, the tag is H1, so H1, and then the attribute is center, and then the text to display is my name there. And so what HTML does is it instructs the browser to display that text with those attributes in heading one format and center aligned. In contrast, take a look at the XML example. So I have a root element people, so this might be a table of different people. And the different people in the table, there are persons. And the first person in the table, the attribute may be sex equals male, and the name is Bruce Fulton. And so that describes a particular person within this table of people. So these are data elements, and there's no display information here, but there is recognizable data, and you can see this. So here's another example. I've extended this a little bit and put in two people, so you can see how these tables are built up. Now we have a name with an ID, maybe an employee ID, employee ID of one, with a first name of Bruce and a last name of Fulton, and a second person with perhaps an employee ID name of two, and a first name of John and a second name of Doe. And so now I think you can begin to see how XML describes data. And so this is in a little computer file on my desktop. I could email this file off, and another person could stick it into an application, and an application would be able to understand that this is now data. So one more thing that we're going to talk about with XML is DTD and schema. DTD stands for document type definition. Schema is another method of doing this. And what DTD and schema are standards for describing what some particular Excel document should look like and contain. And so the DTD or the schema, either one, define things like what element names are allowed in the document, whether those elements are required, optional, repeatable, or conditional, what type of data they are they character data, are they number or date data. And so the DTD and the schema go along with an XML document and define what's legal for that XML document. So an XML document that doesn't violate any of the syntax rules is a valid XML document. So as long as an XML program can read it, then if it doesn't violate any syntax rules, if none of the grammar rules are broken and everything lines up, then we call that a valid XML document. And a document that also conforms to a DTD or schema is said to be well-formed. So let's talk about metadata standards then. Metadata standards are developed by specific communities of practice, including libraries, archives, museums, publishers, to solve specific issues of data description, structure, and exchange. And today they're almost always encoded using XML, which is a W3 consortium open and interoperable standard. The standards are usually expressed or defined using DTDs or schemas. So a metadata standard then is an XML DTD or schema that defines what kind of information can go into an XML document, how it's supposed to be exchanged, how it's arranged. And finally, where does that metadata go? The metadata can go one of really three places. It can be embedded within a digital resource itself. And so let me give you an example for that. Most of you take photographs, I think, on digital cameras these days, take pictures. And the standard one standard that's used to encode photographic information is a JPEG. And so a JPEG is actually a standard for the photograph file. And at the beginning of that file is actually a metadata collection of metadata that tells what is in the photograph. And so it has things like the shutter speed, aperture, and the date that it was taken maybe, and the focal length of the lens. And there's a list of several dozen kind of different metadata. And that's actually encoded right within the JPEG itself. So the beginning of any picture, if you look at the actual digital file, is the metadata. So metadata can be embedded within a digital resource. It can be closely linked to it, and by that I mean it can be placed in the same container, perhaps a folder on your computer. A good example of that would be an ebook. An ebook actually is a type of compressed archive that's got a bunch of other files inside it, and one of the files inside the file that comprises the ebook is a manifest file, and the manifest file has information or metadata about what the other files are, how they're supposed to be ordered, what the table of contents is, and so that's metadata that actually is closely linked to a resource, but not necessarily included in an individual binary file. And then metadata can also be maintained as a separate resource. So I might actually have a digital library that is nothing but metadata and pointers to resources. So I might not have a picture or an ebook or something in my digital library. I might just have a collection of metadata that points to the resources. So let me give you I want to demonstrate this idea of interoperability. So I have an XML file here, and this is the one that we looked at earlier. So I'm going to open this with Notepad just to show you what's in it. Okay, so here's the file that we looked at before, and this is the people example with two people, employee ID, my name and somebody else's name as part of this file, so you can see what's in there. And now let me go back to the desktop again. Now I can open this in Internet Explorer just by double-clicking it. In Internet Explorer, of course, It doesn't have any display information, but Internet Explorer will actually display the information in the file. So it's interoperable in that Internet Explorer recognizes an XML file and knows how to at least display the data that's in it. Now let me also open this up with Excel. And Excel, as you know, is a spreadsheet program for data. I'm going to open this up, and Excel recognizes this as an XML table, and it asks how you'd like to open it up. So I'm going to go ahead and open it up as an XML table and click OK. And it says the XML source does not refer to a schema, and that's true. I didn't remember we talked about DTDs and schemas, and I did not actually create a schema, for this document. But Excel is smart enough to try to figure it out. And so when I click OK here, this actually now creates a table from the XML document. So this should turn on that light bulb over your head that says, well, this really is interoperable display of data, because when I send this XML file around, there are, an almost limitless number of programs that will instantly know how to read this data. And I guarantee this Excel spreadsheet is not going to open up a MARC record. And so I think that concludes the initial discussion on XML as far as I want to take it and in as much technical detail. So we'll go ahead now and start talking about some of the different XML metadata standards, how they're used and what they're good for. Now, the first of the metadata standards that I'd like to talk about is Dublin Core. This is probably the most widely used and best known of any of the metadata standards we're going to talk about. And I'm going to spend a little bit more time on this than I am on the others, because once you understand how Dublin Core works and how it's used and where it's used, then I think the other ones are going to follow right along in line. So Dublin Core, that's Dublin as in Dublin, Ohio, where the first meetings were held, is a standard that is designed to create descriptive records for online resources. And it had its roots back as early as 1995 or so, when it became obvious that, with the World Wide Web at that point having just, kind of come into common use, that there was going to need to be some way to provide information about web resources for the purposes of discovery and retrieval and description. So Dublin Core has been developed over the past more than a decade now, and as a kind of a lightweight tool to describe online resources. And when I say lightweight, it has just 15 elements. We'll take a look at those in just a second, and compare that to MARC, for example, which I don't know how many MARC has, but MARC is certainly much more complex than that. Another key factor that makes Dublin Core so popular is that it's interdisciplinary. So because it's lightweight, it can be used by a lot of different communities of practice to describe resources. And so it's used for exchange of metadata, both within communities of practice and between communities of practice, and of course, for the general public as well. And then finally, it's fairly easily extended by communities of practice to serve special needs. So one community might need to implement it one way. Other communities can easily implement it in other ways to serve their needs. So here are the elements. There are 15 of them. All of the elements are optional, and all of the elements are repeatable, which means a Dublin Core record may contain one sum, all, or multiples. These are fairly self-explanatory, I think. Title, creator, subject. They're the kinds of things that you find in MARC, although there's a much smaller set of them. The link down here, let me see if I can pop that up for you. If you'd like to go take a look at that later and read more about the specifics of each one of these elements and how they're used. So here we are at the element set. This is version 1.1, the current version. And you can scroll down here and look at each of these elements, what the label is, what a definition of that element is, and a comment on it, which gives you some idea of usage. So take a look at those at your leisure. So 15 elements, and that's it. Now, there's one issue that I'd like to talk about when it comes to web resources, and that is whether or not the metadata record describes a class of resources all related, or an individual manifestation of a resource. And so the Dublin Core one-to-one rule says that the metadata describes one manifestation of a version of a resource rather than assuming that manifestations or surrogates stand in for one another. So let me give you an example. Suppose I'm creating a digital library for display, and it's going to be famous artworks. And let's suppose that I put a photograph of the Mona Lisa in my digital collection. Now, the question is, if I look at the metadata for the photograph I have of the Mona Lisa, who is the creator? Who is the person responsible for the creation? And the answer might surprise you a little bit. Dublin Core says that the metadata record for that photograph is the name of the person who took the photograph, not Leonardo da Vinci. This has led to a lot of bad metadata, because the inclination for discovery might be that if I have an image of the Mona Lisa in my digital art collection, that I should probably be talking about Da Vinci as the creator. But in fact, that's not the case, and so the relationship between the metadata for the original and the reproduction is actually part of the metadata description. Now, I can also create a record for the original Mona Lisa, and that's not a digital object, but I could create a record for it. And if I created a record for the original Mona Lisa, then I would be talking about Leonardo da Vinci as being the creator. I would talk about its location being the Louvre. And so all of the metadata would refer to that manifestation of the Mona Lisa. So that's something to keep in mind. There are a couple of workarounds. For example, the Collaborative Digitization Program in Colorado has a best practices for Dublin Core. They actually suggest extending the element set. So they suggest a date original and a date digital element, for example, as one way to kind of get around this. But be aware of this. It's an important concept when you talk about metadata, and I want to bring it to your attention. Now, in addition to the 15 core elements of simple Dublin Core, there is also qualified Dublin Core. And so we have element refinement, and that's qualifiers that make the meaning of an element narrower or more specific. And so the simple Dublin Core element is date. And that can be qualified with certain approved terms. So date created, date valid, date available, date issued, date modified, and so on. So Dublin Core does permit, through the use of qualified Dublin Core, some extensions of initial elements. And the other factor that you have in qualified Dublin Core is a recommendation to use different element encoding schemes to make things consistent. So schemes that aid in the interpretation of an element value, there are several available. One of these is controlled vocabularies. So, for example, when you're talking about subject, you may want to use a encoding scheme, Library of Congress subject headings, Dewey Decimal System, for example. And the other aspect of the element encoding scheme is a formal notation. So the World Wide Web Consortium date format is a standard way of inputting dates so that they can be universally interpreted. And so again, let me just pop the relevant document up. You may want to come back here and take a look at this. So we have the metadata terms here, and if we scroll down the list, these are the terms that have actually been approved by the Dublin Core Metadata Initiative Working Committees as extensions to the simple Dublin Core. And you can read down through each one of these. The organization, for example, here's a term name, access rights. Its label is access rights. It has a certain definition, and it tells you what it refines. In other words, it refines the term rights. And so those access rights as opposed to maybe some other kind of right. So take a look at that and at your leisure, and that will give you some idea of how Dublin Core can be extended. So when we're talking about the qualifiers, the dumbed-down principle is in effect. In other words, Dublin Core says that the simple Dublin Core should stand on its own. And if you use a qualifier, that you should be able to ignore it and use the information as if it were unqualified. And what this has to do with are software applications that are designed to interpret Dublin Core. And they deal with a simple element set. Some individual communities of practice may come up with their own extensions. And when they come up with their own extensions, then certain software applications may not know about them without being programmed. So the dumbed-down principle just says that you ought to be able to take away the qualifier and still use the simple term that it refines, and it should make sense within the application. So I would think of the simple elements as nouns and the qualifiers as adjectives. And now we're going to take a look at Dublin Core in practice. I'm going to show you a digital repository and how Dublin Core looks in there. And I'm also going to show you how data is exchanged between applications. So let's take a look now at how Dublin Core actually functions within a digital collection. We'll take a look at a couple. I'm going to demonstrate Omeka, which is digital repository application that we actually go over in a couple of different Searles classes now. First, let's take a look at a collection that you might be familiar with. This is the Arizona Memory Project. It's actually a collection of collections. Different libraries, museums, archives around the state contribute digital resources. If we take a look at how this is put together, we can look at the collection directory. I will pick one here, say this American Flag Ranch and Acadia Ranch collection. And when we click on that, we see that, first of all, we get some description about the collection and the ranches and so on. And then we actually view the collection, and we can see these are items in here that are on display that you can view. So this is a digital collection. It looks like these are mostly digital surrogates. That is, they're scans or images of historical documents, photographs, and so on. And if we pick one, let's take a look at what the individual item looks like. So we see that this is a hand-canceled stamp from this collection. And if we look down here at the description, light bulb should be lighting up over your head when you look at these terms. This is actually based on Dublin Core. You should, having looked at the elements that we just went over, these are the Dublin Core elements. So we've got title, creator, subject. All of these are Dublin Core elements. Take a look down here. This is interesting. This particular collection has adopted that CBD extension to Dublin Core using date original. So we see that the date original now refers to this actual the date of the actual object rather than the date of the scan of the object. And so that clarifies it for us. And this is certainly one way to resolve the one-to-one issue that we talked about a little while ago. So this should give you a pretty good idea, I think, already of how Dublin Core facilitates description, discovery, and access of digital resources on the web. So this is a web-based collection. If you want to take a look at how we actually construct that, I have a demonstration set up here. This is the application Omeka. We talk about how to build collections using this and a number of other collection applications in IRLS 675. So if you take that class, you'll learn how to do this. So we're looking at a collection here, and we see that we have a few items in this collection. This is actually an application running in a virtual machine on my desktop. If we want to add an item to this collection, log into the administrator panel and add a new collection to the archive. And we start right out with Dublin Core. First, I'm actually going to go get an item to look at. So we're going to browse here and come up with here's a photograph of some javelinas. We'll go back to Dublin Core here. And so these are all the Dublin Core simple elements, title, javelinas, subject, wildlife, Arizona, description, photograph of a javelina. Creator, that's going to be me. And note, again, recall that Dublin Core elements are repeatable, so I could add another creator by clicking this button here. So if there were a co-photographer or somebody else who helped build this, then we could add that. And recall also that the Dublin Core elements are optional, so we don't have to fill all of these in. So it doesn't have a publisher, I'll leave that blank. Date, I'll put in a simple date format. We'll leave contributor rights relation. We'll leave these blank for now, just for purposes of demonstration. We'll take a look at the item type. This happens to be a still image. And so that gives us the opportunity to put a little bit more discussion into what this is. I'm going to call this image. That's a standardized way of inputting data about a JPEG image. The collection, we're going to put this in the mostly Arizona collection. We've already got the files. Tags, if I wanted to put any social tags into this application, I could put some there. I'm going to let that alone for now. I'm going to make this public, and I'm going to make this featured. I'm going to click Add the Item, and it'll take a few seconds to upload that. So basically, this is how collections are built, and it's relatively easy to do, and it's made easy and standard because of the Dublin Core metadata now. Digital repository applications can use other metadata schemas besides Dublin Core. So there are ways of configuring this if you wanted to use another one, but the vast majority of these kind of digital repositories that you see out there are now actually based in Dublin Core. It's kind of a standard approach now for these collections. So we can see that we've entered this now. If we view the public site, what the public sees, this would be the home page, recently added items and so on, we can browse this collection and see the items in here, and we can select them and see the Dublin Core metadata. And so if we were looking for objects in these digital collections, and we go on the search, or we go in, say, to the advanced search, collection type user tags, we can basically look for information that's stored by the Dublin Core fields. And now I'm going to give you an introduction to how this information can be shared among repositories. And for that, we're going to go to the Metadata Harvesting and Exchange, and that's with the Open Archives Initiative Protocol for Metadata Harvesting. And now we're going to take a look at that using the same Omeka application. So let's talk about how we might exchange information about collections, and in particular the metadata about collections. One very popular way to do it, not the only way, but it's an important way and one that you should know about, is the OAI-PMH. That's the Open Archives Initiative Protocol for Metadata Harvesting. It actually is in part an XML metadata specification in that it has a schema. It has its own set of elements that it uses, and it uses those elements to collect and exchange information between repositories. It was developed principally in the beginning for preprint and eprint servers. Those are servers that house open access journal articles, scholarly writings, things like that. But in fact, now it's used for the exchange of metadata between all different kinds of digital collections, and not just for text, but for any kind of digital resource. And again, keep in mind that what we're exchanging here is not necessarily the resource itself, but the metadata about the resource, and that's for purposes of discovery and then eventually retrieval. So there are really two kinds of operators in the OAI-PMH world. There are data providers, and so those are people who house collections of items, and they want to make that metadata available to others to gather. And then, of course, there are service providers, who are those people who then collect, harvest, and aggregate metadata, and then share it, and in the process oftentimes add value. And by that I mean not every collection is a complete collection. So suppose there's a particular topic and there are five or six different collections out there, all of which have items that contribute to a particular subject. And so what a service provider will do is the service provider will get the metadata from all of those collections, kind of bundle it together, put it in one place, and make some sense out of it. So people who provide data and then people who collect that data, aggregate it, and add value to it. The protocol itself is really fairly simple. We're going to take a look at it in just a second. It's comprised of it takes place over the web, so it's comprised of a base URL. And then there are six what we call verbs that are used to retrieve collection information and metadata. And I'm going to show you what those are just right now. If you're interested in more of this, there's a fairly extensive tutorial available. The link is down there. You're welcome to look at it in more detail. I'm just going to give you a very brief overview of how to do a data provision, and then how to do a simple harvest. So let's go back up to our website here. So I've created this little demonstration set, and suppose I want to make this available to people. Now, of course, you know, an individual can just come to this site, browse the collection, do search terms on it. So that's one way you can get the metadata. But what we're really talking here is application-to-application metadata sharing that machines do automatically. And so if I want to become a data provider, I need to enable certain functionality on this. It's done different ways on different repositories. This particular one has a kind of a plug-in, and it just turns it into a data provider. And what that does is it creates a URL that you can access that you can combine with one of those verbs. And so let me show you exactly what I mean by that. The URL, and again, keep in mind that this is a demonstration system running in a virtual machine on my desktop, so this isn't a real URL. You won't be able to come to this. But the URL itself is the URL for the repository, and then it's usually some subdirectory. And you can see here that this is the URL portion of the address right here. And then when I say a verb, this particular verb is identified. So when I go to this URL and ask it to identify itself, it will give me the name of the repository where the information is stored. And so when I type this URL into the browser, I get back a response in XML. That says the repository name is IRLS675. That's the name of the repository, where it is, the version I'm using, the administrator's email address. There's additional information. I think you get the idea. Now, if I actually want to know what is in this repository, I can ask it to list the sets. And it looks just exactly the same. Here is the base URL, and I've issued the verb to list sets. And I only have one set in the demonstration collection, if you'll recall, it's that mostly Arizona. So it's giving me the name of the set that's there. Now, there are basically four other verbs, compound verbs. They get more complicated, but what they do is they now allow me knowing the name of the repository and the name of the sets that are in there to select sets to collect metadata from them. And that metadata, for the most part, is going to come back in Dublin Core format. Now, OAI-PMH does support other protocols besides Dublin Core, but I would say the vast majority of them are exchanging Dublin Core metadata. So by doing this, I've exposed my collection to harvest by machines or applications rather than just humans visiting my site. Now, if I actually wanted to harvest metadata, if I wanted to turn my collection into a service provider, let's talk about the Library of Congress. The Library of Congress uses OAI-PMH to expose an extraordinarily large number of documents and collections. And so they're probably much more interesting than my little demonstration collection would be. And again, it's a simple matter of combining a base URL. And here's the base URL for the Library of Congress's memory project. And if we can combine those with a couple of those verbs, first of all, we can look at how it identifies itself. And it identifies itself, with a little bit more information than my simple demonstration. We see this is the Library of Congress Open Archive Initiative Repository Number 1. We see a number of email addresses for admins, so if we had questions about it, we could contact them. Date stamps, different kinds of information about policies, and this is all the part of that OAI-PMH metadata standard, the information that comes back. We can also take a look at what it would be to list sets, so I'll just pop that in here. And now we get the information about the individual collections, and there are a large number of collections. So we start out here with list sets. That's the command that we gave. And then we can see each set in turn. We can kind of collapse this and notice that there are lots and lots of different sets. So this particular set is the African American photographs assembled for 1900 Paris exhibition. We see a description down here. All of that's very well and good. And now the question is, how do we harvest this in a way that makes it useful? So let's go back to repository again. So now we're back at the repository, and what I've done, let's go to the admin panel. Here's the admin panel. And I've actually installed an application within this repository to be able to harvest OAI-PMH data. So let's open that up. And here, all I need to do is put in that base URL. So give me just a second while I type that in for you. All right, so here's our base URL, and I'm going to view sets. And of course, now what's going to happen is that the program is just going to issue the same list sets command that I issued manually. But it will parse all the information that is. It will read through it, and it will present it in a way that's useful to me. And now I've got my choice of actually harvesting that data. So we can look through. We could either harvest the entire repository. That would take days. I mean, it's huge, and that's not even pulling the resources themselves. But I can harvest the individual collections or sets within the repository. Let's pick one that's maybe fairly small. I'm not sure which of these. Well, we'll just pick one and see. So let me click on Go for this Brady Handy collection. We'll see what it comes up with. I'm going to click Go, and it's going to start. It's going to start harvesting those. Records. Now, this is actually going to take a while, so I'm going to pause the recording, and I'm going to come back when it's done, because it could take several minutes to complete. All right, we're back. That took about 6 or 7 minutes, according to our status page. You can see down here it's completed. And so now we've performed our harvest. Let's see what we've actually got. I'm going to go to the public site now and see what we've got if we go to our items page. These are all the items that have been added, and if we take a look at what we actually harvested, again, this is all coming from the Dublin Core information that was sent over. It was sent over via XML, the OAI-PMH standard, and you can see that there a lot of these fields are blank. As you recall with Dublin Core, they're not required. A lot of the photographic collections of the Library of Congress are not always well documented. In fact, they have a Flickr page, photo sharing page, where they've put a lot of these photographs up, and they've asked people to comment on them and add information. But this is the information that we've harvested. So now we have we should see this over on the public site here, browse collections. And we can see that we now have the original collection that we've got and this Brady Handy collection. We can end the public page, search on these now, browse the collection. And so that's how information is exchanged among applications, between applications. And that's an important message for XML. It is interoperable. It is for the exchange of data. That's what it's designed for. And so that's a good introduction, I think, to the Dublin Core. And to the ways Dublin Core data can be exchanged. We're now going to go over a few more of these metadata standards. There are a few more that I think are important for you to know that we'll talk about. And they're all going to work similar to these. So we're going to be looking at what kind of information they're designed to talk about, you know, what collections they're useful for, what communities of practice, and how they're implemented in this online world of digital resources. Next up in our metadata zoo is the metadata encoding transmission standard. And this is a different kind of standard than the ones that we've just looked at. Dublin Core and MARC are what we might call descriptive standards. They describe the characteristics and attributes of a particular resource, those things that directly relate to the description of the resource. But there are other kinds of metadata that need to be tracked besides just the descriptive metadata. There are a few different ways these are sometimes broken down. You can think of them as structural metadata, administrative data, preservation metadata, rights metadata. In some cases, people consider preservation metadata and rights metadata to be part of the administrative metadata. But you can see that these are items of information that relate to the resource but don't necessarily describe the resource itself. We still need to know about them. We need to know about the preservation. We need to know about provenance. We need to know, you know, perhaps a more nuanced version of the rights than just the simple rights declaration we see in a Dublin Core or MARC record. And so the metadata encoding transmission standard is really kind of a wrapper that allows you to include all kinds of descriptive, structural, administrative metadata in a package and send it along. So let's take a look at how this looks in a kind of a institutional repository framework. And so we're going to look at the Open Archival Information System reference model. And this is just a schematic diagram. If you look at a website, you know, a digital library or, you know, some kind of digital display, there's actually a lot more going on behind the scenes than just the input of the descriptive information into a repository like Omeka. It's actually a process, and the OAIS, Open Archival Information System, is a framework that describes the people and the systems, and it's also a conceptual model. So if you look at this from left to right, we have people that produce the information that's going to go in our digital repository. It could be a library, digital library, could be, you know, archive, digital archive, museum, and so on. And the information flows through here, so the person that produces it collects the resource, packages up the resource, and all the information about the resource, that goes in through a process called ingest into the system. That goes into a data management plan, may go into archival storage. At some point, it goes into some kind of a system that provides access that allows you to search and query. And then finally, the consumer, when he's looking at it, issues queries, gets back results sets, and so on. So this is a kind of an overview of the overall concept of a digital repository as a system. And information needs to travel through the system. It travels in information packages. The OAIS reference model defines three stages of information packages. There's a submission information package, SIP, the archival information package, AIP, and the dissemination information package, which is the DIP. You can see those indicated here. They all basically may contain pretty much the same information, but of course what the consumer gets back out isn't necessarily what the producer of the information puts in. So these do vary in format. But I think the point here is that the metadata encoding transmission standard is the standard that allows us to package up all that information together and send it through the system. So all of those packages, the SIP, AIP, and DIP, are actually packaged according to this METS schema. And sent along the system. And it's interpreted in much the way, I'm not going to give you a live demonstration of this, but these are interpreted by computer programs. Computer programs are written to handle the input and move them through the system, and so on. So METS is an XML schema, expresses the structure of digital library objects, names and locations of the associated files, and the associated metadata. And the metadata model for OAIS is METS. A METS document is an XML document, looks like ones we've looked at before. It's comprised of seven sections. It's got a header that just gives some basic information about what the package is. There is a section that contains the descriptive metadata, and that can be either embedded in the METS package itself, or it can be a separate file that the METS package refers to. And the interesting thing about the descriptive metadata is that the descriptive metadata can be expressed as Dublin Core, MARC XML, MODS, which we're going to look at in a minute, EAD, Enhanced Archival Description, which we'll look at it in a minute. In other words, the METS standard actually can wrap around other standards and include them. So this is a way of being able to include your Dublin Core MARC XML metadata in this package. It handles this through a XML technique we call namespacing. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that, but namespacing is just a way of indicating in an XML document the schema that the data comes from, and I'm actually going to show you that in a minute. But that's the way we can look at a METS standard, METS package, and be able to tell where the information came from, what it conforms to. So then the next section is the administrative metadata. Again, that can actually be embedded into the METS file itself, or it can be a separate file, and it can that's referenced within the METS package. There are four sections of administrative metadata, technical, intellectual property, source metadata, and then provenance metadata. And then there's some structural issues. Now, keep in mind that a digital resource can actually be kind of a package of digital resources. So, for example, if the resource is an electronic book, the individual chapters of the electronic book might all be separate files, and of course, then the images might be separate files from that. So, a digital resource can be comprised of multiple files, and so the METS package is also critical in being able to tell the application, how these things need to be reconstructed. So there's also a list of files, a structural map, structural links, and then some behaviors which may indicate, how a particular resource needs to be handled. There may be a program or an application necessary to open it or display it or do something. So those are the sections of the metadata encoding transmission standard. And let's go back just a second to the OAIS reference model. You can see how that information now moves through the system. It moves from process to process, machine to machine. There might be a dozen different applications, computer applications in here that handle all that data. And so this is a standardized way of moving information from one end of the chain to the other. There's a tutorial here that goes into this in much more detail. I'm going to let you look at that on your own if you want to. It's not very long, but it will give you some additional information on what these sections comprise, what kind of data goes in them. We'll take a quick look at a sample file here. Just to see what a METS package looks like. And we'll spend a lot of time on this, but you can see that we have the METS header record here. This is the information about the file. We can collapse that structure. I guess one thing I want to highlight here is when it comes down to the descriptive metadata, that's METS descriptive metadata, you can see this namespacing, and that's the string of characters before the colon and before the actual label. So we can see that DMD sec fedora is actually an element in the METS metadata schema. But as we come down here, we can see now that the descriptive schema that we're using to express this descriptive metadata is actually the Dublin Core. So this is Dublin Core title, Dublin Core creator, Dublin Core subject. And that's the way that this METS package is used to kind of wrap around all of these other schemas and metadata standards and create a package that moves information through the system. So that concludes METS. We're going to go and take a look at a couple of more metadata standards that have to do with descriptive metadata and a couple that are kind of hybrids. So we mentioned MODS just a few minutes ago in connection with the METS, which is the Metadata Encoding Transmission Standard. MODS stands for Metadata Object Description Schema, and it's another descriptive metadata standard. It's similar to Dublin Core or MARC. Actually, it comes from the Library of Congress, their Network Development and Standards Office. It's an Excel schema that was originally designed for libraries, but now it's used for many other digital resources, music scores, recordings, things like that. And it's very useful for digital resources. In fact, it is a MARC derivative. That is, it's similar in scope to MARC. It has a few differences from MARC. Now, of course, you can get MARC XML, so you can get a version of MARC expressed in XML that is the full MARC standard. But this is a derivative of MARC, and so they've made a few changes. One of the changes they've made are language tags are more friendly than the MARC numeric tags. So instead of all those numbers you see in the MARC record, like 650 and for subject and some of those other numeric tags, MODS uses natural language tags, so they're a little bit more reader friendly. It's simpler than full MARC, but it's quite a bit richer than Dublin Core. So this is a rich but supposedly fairly easy to use descriptive schema. It is harvestable through the OAI-PMH. So if you'll recall our example from a little bit earlier in the lecture when we harvested the Dublin Core records, most of the metadata harvesters will also harvest MODS data, so that's a choice. And the main thing, since it comes from Library of Congress, is that it plays well with METS. METS and MODS really are kind of designed to go together. Mods plays very well in the descriptive portion of the Met's record. If we take a look at it, at the elements, we can see that you know, we have a few, a handful of primary elements, and so this already is a little bit more rich than Dublin Core. And what you find when you actually drill into this is that there are considerably larger number of sub-elements and attributes that modify these. So you can get quite a bit more information than the simple Dublin Core. If you're interested in taking a look at the elements and their attributes, I've included a link down here that gives you an outline of these major elements and what can qualify each one of those, what the sub-elements are, and the attributes that can qualify them. And if you're interested in seeing how METs and MODs works together, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that, really any more than I've mentioned already, that MODs fits well within the METs descriptive section. But there's a lengthy slideshow also referenced here if you want to find out a little bit more about how METs and MODs work together. And you can check that out on your own if you're interested. Now I'd like to talk to you about a couple of standards that are used for archives and for preservation of digital resources. The first we're going to talk about is the encoded archival description, EAD, which has to do with creation of digital finding aids. And the second is the PREMIS, the Preservation Metadata Implementation Strategies for Digital Preservation. So the encoded archival description standard is a collaboration between the Library of Congress and the Society of American Archivists. This actually puts into the digital realm a documents describing a variety of standardized practices around the creation of finding aids. And so the EAD schema actually is the online version of what archivists have been doing for quite some time, non-proprietary de facto standard for the encoding of finding aids for use in a networked online environment. So archivists have been creating finding aids, well, and actually librarians do too, finding aids for quite some time. And finding aids are inventories, indexes, or guides that are created by archival and manuscript repositories to provide information about specific collections. So, for example, suppose some famous person donates a box or two boxes or you know, a dozen boxes of their papers to a library or archives. And so a finding aid is a document that guides you through what is in that collection. So it'll have a section that tells you about the collection in general, who donated it, generally what's in the collection, the you know, biographies perhaps of the individuals involved, and that's a collection level description. And then they oftentimes also get down into item level descriptions. So there might be particular papers that would be described, and so it would say this particular paper is about this particular subject, and it's in box 7 on the shelf. And so that's what a finding guide is. And so the common purpose here is to provide detailed description of the content and intellectual organization of collections of archival materials. And so what EAD does is it provides the an XML way, much the same as the other standards we've been talking about exchanging this information. Exchanging information both between people and collections and also machines, computer applications which can interpret this information provided by this metadata scheme and then display it in applications. I'm not gonna list the elements. There are 146 of them, and those have attributes and qualifiers. So you can see that this is significantly more complex than Dublin Core mods that we've looked at before. There's a set of best practices at the link here. You can look that up on your own. I'm going to show you a quick sample. I think when you see it, it'll give you an idea of exactly what a finding aid is and what this encoded archival description standard looks like. So here we see this, I think, is a sample finding aid for a collection of materials related to the Mildred Davenport dance programs and dance school. And apparently a bunch of materials were contributed to some institution, and this is the finding aid that was created. So we'll look through the sections here. Of course, you have the first section here is the header section. And so we see that this is the guide to the Mildred Davenport dance programs, the author processed by machine-readable finding aid created by Adrian Turner, when and where. So we have the information that's in the header record about what this generally is. Then we have the front matter, title page, basically, who it's processed by, date completed, and so on. And if we scroll down here a little bit farther, we get to the archive description area, which is the meat of the EAD record, and we see that this is at the collection level. So this is the section of the document that describes the collection as a whole. So again, we have the title, country, repository, where it is. We have important information for users of the collection, access, who can get at it, and so on. So this is information about the collection level. We have a section on biographies, who the people are that were involved, including dates and so on. And then if we scroll down here farther, we can actually start to see item level descriptions. So, for example, there is a box or a folder. The label of the box is 1, and the title of this particular item in the collection is Mildred Davenport and Her Pupils. I'm assuming that, perhaps this is a photograph or some kind of document that describes Mildred Davenport and her pupils. So that's what a finding aid looks like. And, of course, this would be interpreted by a computer application displayed on a screen so that you could find the information easily and search, locate the information, and know where to look for it. Now let's go on to our second one, preservation metadata implementation strategies. And this this has to do with digital preservation. Digital preservation is a process and set of activities designed to assure that a digital resource is accessible over time. And it includes processes like replication, migration, and emulation. Some things to consider with digital preservation: you need to store it securely so that no one can modify it. So if it's a digital resource, you do things like checksums, which are a way of looking at a digital file and making sure that it hasn't been modified, that it's the same file that you actually put in there. They need to be stored on media that can be used over time. So, there are a lot of media. You may remember floppy disks. Hardly anybody uses floppy disks anymore. So if information was originally stored on a floppy disk, then the preservation strategy might be that you have to migrate that, replicate it, perhaps put it into a different format so that you can get at the information that was on that. And so we have to deal with obsolete file formats. We might need to change application software, how it's rendered. So digital preservation is actually a whole process. And if we look at what PREMIS is, PREMIS is actually a data dictionary. And a data dictionary is a kind of a higher level abstraction. This is the set of all the terms and things that are necessary to support the digital preservation process. So this is a little bit above the XML schema. If you look at the diagram here, we've talked about other kinds of metadata that talk about description, the administrative metadata like agents' rights and so on. Repository business rules is something that has to do with, if you think back on the OAIS framework, managing the repository. Then there's the technical metadata format specific. And so the preservation metadata information strategies really is kind of at the middle of all of that. And so when you look at the document, it's actually not an XML document. It's actually a text, a couple of hundred pages that lists lots of different terms and how they're used and what they mean in the context of preservation. Now, when you exchange that information, then it is expressed in XML. So if you need to take some PREMIS data using that schema and send it off to another application or process, then that will be converted to XML. PREMIS refers either to the working group. There is an XML schema that's available for interchange of information, or the PREMIS data dictionary itself. I've listed several resources here if you want to look at this on your own. This is a little bit more complex a standard than some of the others, so I'm not going to try to show examples of it. But if you're interested, you might hit up a couple of these links, take a look at those, and in particular, you can take a look at the examples. So some of those go on for several pages, but they are basically in English charts that you can actually read and see how the terminology applies. And then if you look at those examples, you can imagine that if that data would need to be exchanged with other applications, then that would be converted to XML and exchanged just as any of the other standards we've looked at. The next specification we're going to take a look at strays outside the boundaries of libraries and cultural heritage organizations, but it's nevertheless is an important one to know, particularly if you have any interest at all in books and publishing, and most librarians do have an interest in books and publishing. And this is the Online Information Exchange for Books, shorthand as ONIX. It's actually a family of standards by EditEar for publishing. They also have specifications for serials and a couple of other products, but the book specification is certainly the most widely known and used, and usually when you hear the word ONIX, they're talking about the book specification. So this is an XML specification with a published DTDN schema, implementation guides, and best practices. And what this is all of the book industry product information in electronic form that goes from the publisher all the way to the retailer and everybody in between. It is all of the data you need to know to publish, transport, market, sell, whatever, books. And so publishers, retailers, channels to market is a term that is sometimes applied to online retailers like Amazon and some of the many online stores where you can buy books and digital resources. Everyone in the publishing supply chain uses this information. So the benefits for the publishers, it's a standard format for book metadata that reduces costs. It sometimes can be expensive to implement initially, but in the long term it reduces costs because they have a standard format for outputting this data. They can output it once in one format and not have to worry about producing different formats for different different entities in the supply chain. And it aggregates a lot of different types of metadata. So it's not only the book description, but it's everything from the size of the book to how many books come in a crate to how much that crate weighs to who's reviewed it, pretty much anything that is of interest to the supply chain and to retailers in order to market the book. And of course, for retailers, this is efficient for retailers, and especially for online retailers. They can absorb one of these XML packages, XML messages, if you will, and those can go directly into their web presence point of sale systems with very little, if any, manual intervention. So this makes it easy for publishers and transmit the data in a standardized way, and easy for retailers to accept data and get data that will help them sell books in a standardized way. Specification itself has over 200 elements, and a lot of those have attributes, qualifiers, and values. In other words, one field might be type of publisher, and that might be a number from 1 to 20, and each one of those numbers would be a different type of publisher, a different characteristic, whatever. The current version we're on is 2.x. There is a new standard out now. It's being slowly adopted that deals much more effectively with electronic books. You see that there have been problems with the old spec and in the supply chain in general, dealing with different versions, different kinds of formats, digital rights management. And by this I mean, suppose Simon & Schuster produces an ebook. Well, that ebook is produced in perhaps two or three different formats, EPUB, Amazon format, and so on. That goes through different different vendors, different intermediaries who might add the digital rights management, who might add packaging to it, and then it gets perhaps even assigned new numbers when it goes into the Amazon market, when it goes into the Barnes & Noble market, when it goes into the Sony market. And so all these different versions of things were stressing the old specification. So we do have a new specification out that is about ready to take off for all these new new kinds of digital resources. If you look at the spec itself, you can see that this is a pretty comprehensive spec. It's divided into six blocks, 26 different groups, and as you look at these, keep in mind that each one may have several different attributes or ways of qualifying each one of these. So there's a product description form. This would be similar to what we would find in Dublin Core or MARC or MODS. In addition, the spec itself contains the administrative metadata, the marketing, digital rights, and so on, publishing detail, marketing detail, supply, you know, all the different information about the characteristics of the book. It even includes provision for additional images, for tables of content, for reviews, for quotes. So this is a comprehensive spec that serves the industry well for all of the information related to publishing a book and selling it in the retail market. So why do they do this? Well, the fact of the matter is that metadata sells. Nielsen has done a study with a UK book industry communications group, and they looked at how complete the metadata was for different categories of books. That is, when a publisher releases an Onyx record, how complete is it? How much information did they give? Here are a few statistics that should tell you exactly why publishers are interested in complete metadata. 98% higher if it contains a basic standard set of metadata coverage that would include author, title, subject, price, ISBN, cover image, date, supplier, availability, and the rights associated with it. That would be considered standard metadata. Image has a really strong impact if you can include an image, the cover art, for example, with that metadata. They're seeing a 268% increase in sales over titles whose metadata does not include that image. There are enhanced metadata elements defined by Nielsen, including various categories of description, short description, long description, critical trade reviews, author biographies, table of contents. So those enhanced metadata elements also help raise sales. And then it, if you look at the online sales in particular, where, you know, the only way you usually find out about things is through online, the vendors such as Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and some of the other online stores, there's a rather staggering increase in the percent sales increase when you include the full range of metadata, because that's how readers discover it on the web. Is this metadata flows through? It goes through the retailers. Consumers have a good opportunity to evaluate the book and see if it's something they want to buy. Now, there's some Onyx resources here. I'll let you go on your own if you want to read up on those. We can take a brief look at an Onyx record just to give you an idea of what that looks like. Now, it looks like pretty much any of the other XML records we've looked at, but I think you'll be impressed with the level of detail in here. So we'll just scan through a couple of sections of this. It's a fairly long record. We have a header information, of course, which includes the different kinds of book numbers, the product information, ISBN numbers, and so on, product detail, barcode information, titles, number of pieces. We go through here the contributor information, some fairly extensive biographical information, person name inverted, names before key, biographical notes, contributor statements. Patrick trained as a teacher and spent most of his life teaching. So you can get these kind of quotes into an Onyx record where you wouldn't necessarily see those in, say, a Dublin Core MODS or a MARC record. Of course, language. We can take a look down here at some text, local Irish history, subject headings, other text, audience codes, formats. home tourism, urban renewal industry, Tour de France contact, so on. You can see some of that information there. As we scroll down here, we can see that we have a product website design. We can see quotes from newspapers. So the Waterford News here says this is quite simply the best book on the history of Dungarvan. So this is included in part of this marketing metadata. Website metadata, prizes. We can see that it won a prize, some kind of book prize, and so on. So that's probably it for now. You can come back and take a look at this if you want to scroll through these, but I think you get the idea that for publishers, Onyx is a really important tool, not only for reader discovery, but also for sales. And I also want to call your attention to the link here. I won't take a look at it, but there is some intersection between Onyx and libraries. Libraries are interested in this kind of metadata as well. If you look at the OPAC now, you're seeing more examples of OPACs that bring in examples of, say, cover art and might include a review. And so there's active work going on now between the Onyx groups and the MARC groups and the people who create the library OPACs to look at this information. This is still early stages, but libraries are interested in consuming Onyx metadata, and so we'll expect to see a lot more on that in the coming years. Now, I do want to mention briefly the RSS family of XML standards, and it's a family. There are a few standards out that compete. There's RSS, a few different versions of RSS, and ATOM, which is also very similar to RSS. These are specifications that are used to syndicate information resources. And by syndicate, I mean that suppose you're the Associated Press and you're publishing all these news articles. Well, you want to distribute those out to all of the newspapers and TV stations and websites in the country. And so that's a syndicator. You're syndicating this news. You're making it available for publication. You're pushing it out, pushing out the news. And on the flip side of it are the data aggregators, and those would be things like your local newspaper, which gets information from the Associated Press, gets information from Reuters. Online versions, of course, are things like MSN, Yahoo. If you have an MSN or a Yahoo homepage, these are a bunch of news articles. Those articles are grabbed through this process of syndication from a variety of different sources. RSS is the XML specification that's used to exchange that data back and forth. So the XML RSS spec says, well, this is the particular news feed. This is Article 1. Here's what Article 1 contains. This is Article 2. This is what Article 2 contains, and so on. And you should see a similarity there to the OAI-PMH data providers, which are the institutions that make data about their collections available, and the service providers who harvest that information, put it together, and make it useful to others. So this is exactly the same process we're talking about there. And the reason that I bring it up here, and I'm just going to touch on this briefly, it's a little bit outside the realm of the other XML standards we've looked at, but increasingly libraries and cultural heritage institutions are using RSS to syndicate new content that they're getting into their collections. So, for example, a library might syndicate new books that it bought. It might have several different RSS channels about different categories of books, fiction, nonfiction, and so on. Museums might use this to add to their collection. And so the what happens then is that you, as an end user consumer, would have an application that it would allow you to go out and read these news feeds that would alert you to when new things have come in without you having to go out periodically and visit all these sites. So it's a way to become informed about the news. An example of a repository that is using RSS is the University of Arizona's own D-List, Digital Library of Information Science and Technology. We'll go take a quick look at that so I can show you what I'm talking about. So here's the D-List repository, cross-institutional, subject-based, open-access digital archive. And you can see here, if you go to the page, you can see latest submissions in this collection. And in order to keep up with this without RSS, you would just have to visit this page periodically and take a look and see what the new submissions were to see if there were something you'd be interested even. But over here, notice that we have an RSS feed, and you see this symbol on a lot of websites. This just means that they are producing a feed that is in the RSS specification that allows you to subscribe to their content without having to visit their site to see whether the content is new or not. So if we click on that, that's actually going to open up the XML. This is interpreted by the browser, and so I'm going to view the page source, and we can actually look at the XML. And now this should look awfully familiar to you by now as far as an XML. And so let's just break this down a little bit. Channel, this is the U of A campus repository collection. It tells you the link, this description, and so on. And then we're looking at the individual items. So here's an item, International UDC Seminar, Classification and Ontology, a report. So this is one of the new items in the collection. And that here's another new item in the collection, Facets in UDC, a review of current situation. This is another article. And as you can see, it lists the top 5 or 10 or however many you program new articles in there. And so that's what the RSS feed is. Now, if you let me close this. If we were to go out to a reader, I've subscribed to a few things. So now we can see that when I go to my reader, I find what's new from all of the different places that I subscribe from. So I can see the first few here from the U of A campus repository. Searles itself also broadcasts an RSS feed of new podcasts and new recordings that it makes. So here are the new recordings that I haven't listened to for Searles. So that's just a brief little summary of RSS, pretty much all you need to know about it. But I did want to mention it because it is an XML specification that is a lot of libraries, cultural heritage institutions are beginning to use to advertise their collections and to, again, help with the process of discovery. So let's pause at this point and kind of summarize where we have been for the last hour or so. We've been talking about resource discovery and the XML standards that facilitate resource discovery and also access and retrieval. These are metadata standards that are written in XML that allow us to categorize information about resources, exchange information between applications, facilitates the input of data into applications that humans can use to find and access information. So we've talked about XML as the lingua franca of the web. It's the encoding standard. It's what basically all of these other standards are written in or expressed in. We've looked at some purely resource description standards that describe the resource itself. It's MARC, which we're assuming you knew something about before you watched this lecture. And then Dublin Core XML, which is a general purpose descriptive standard for any variety of resources on the web. MARC XML, which is an actual faithful XML rendition of the MARC standard. MODS, the metadata object description schema, which is derived from MARC, is a little bit simpler, uses more human-friendly terms, and is designed to be a little bit easier to use. Encoded archival description for the creation of finding aids for libraries and archives. PREMIS, the preservation metadata data dictionary, which at a high level is not really an XML standard, but when implemented in the context of information exchange is usually expressed as XML, and that has to do with digital preservation, the whole process of digital preservation. We've looked at METS, which is really a wrapper that allows us to encapsulate resource description standards as well as administrative metadata within a package for description. ONIX is kind of an all-in-one. It has both resource description standards and also the embedded data that has to do with the administrative marketing and so on. And then we've looked at harvesting, syndication, and aggregation standards that allow us to pull in information from a variety of providers about information or, conversely, to publish the information that we have. And so that's the OAI-PMH, the protocol for metadata harvesting, and also RSS, which is kind of a general purpose harvesting syndication specification. And so all of these really have to do with resource discovery on the web, finding individual resources. And so I wanted to present that to you to kind of sum up what we've done so far. In the next section, I'm going to touch very briefly on what it takes to organize information itself on the web. If you view the web as the resource, then what is it? What can we use that actually defines and enables us to categorize all the information that's on the web? And that's in the next section. So in order to talk about organizing information on the web, the semantic web, we need to back up a little and talk about just a couple of more standards. This is going to be a real high-level overview. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, but I think I can get across the object of what's going on here in a fairly simple way. But know that I'm leaving out a lot, and this is a pretty high-level overview. The first standard I want to talk about is resource description framework. And resource description framework is actually a conceptual language for representing information about resources in the World Wide Web. And it's a language that is specific to machines being able to interpret or separate out the different parts of the statement that you might make about a resource on the World Wide Web. And so it's based on really three very simple things. It's the notion that anything on the web is identified by what we call a URI. A URI is a uniform resource identifier. You may be thinking of URL, Uniform Resource Locator. That's one way to identify things on the web. There are a couple of other ways. There's Uniform Resource Name. And all of these together we call Uniform Resource Identifiers. You can think of it as a URL. Most examples are going to turn out to be URLs, so I don't want that term to be confusing. So anyway, we have the idea of identifying a resource that has a uniform resource identifier on the web. And then we talk about those resources in terms of properties and property values. And the way that this is done is through what's called a triple, the RDF triple. And it's just simply a way of saying that a resource, the subject, has a property, which is a predicate, of a specific value, which is an object. So we have subject, predicate, and value. And let me give you an example of that here. So in English, I might say the author of the web page is John Smith. And it turns out that that's not, while it's very understandable to us, it's not particularly understandable to machines. And so RDF says that the proper way to express that is to break this into the subject, the predicate, and the object. And so the subject here is actually web page. Web page is the resource that we're talking about. A web page is identified by a URI. The predicate that we're talking about is the property that we want to get at. In this case, we want to know who the author of the web page is. So author is the predicate. And it turns out that the name of the author, the value of that predicate, is John Smith. And so we have a subject, example.org/index.html, that's the subject, has a property called creator, that's the predicate, and if you'll recall, that's a Dublin Core term, whose value is John Smith. That is, John Smith is the name given to the creator of the subject, the resource page. And so that's the idea of RDF in a nutshell. It's just a particular way of expressing it. You can think of it as syntax, if you like. And it turns out that this happens to be useful for machines. It's often expressed as a graph. RDF isn't inherently expressed in any particular language. It's a descriptive framework, and so it's actually kind of English-based when you read about it. And it's often in that context expressed as a graph. So let's break out this example that we've been working on just a little bit farther. You can see down here we have a kind of a green blob with a subject at the top. We have an arrow pointing down to another URL, and that turns out to be the object. And then we have a line pointing from the top to the bottom. And on that line is another URL. And that may look a little bit confusing, but let's break it down. So the first green blob at the top is the subject, and that's the particular web page that we're talking about. As we go down, we see the URL next to the line. Recall that Dublin Core actually is a schema that defines 15 elements, and one of those 15 elements is the creator. So we can actually refer to the place on the web where the Dublin Core schema talks about the actual attribute of creator, and that's our predicate. And then the object, here's another URL, which again may be a little bit curious, but it turns out that that may be the URL that describes or has information about John Smith. And so this is the way RDF begins to link information in ways that computers can understand it. Now let's take a look at a little bit more extended version. The top green blob at the top, and then the middle one are what we brought over from the other page. In this case, the second green blob is the object, the website that describes this particular person. And that website might also contain literal values. John Smith is the particular name. Notice the RDF triplet. When you look at the second green blob as a subject, then the predicate here is the name contained within that particular website. And the value of that name is John Smith. And then there might also be other information. His age on that website might be listed as 27. So again, this is the way RDF continues to expand down as you go into information. It turns out to be that this is pretty useful for machines. We extend RDF, which is a conceptual language or conceptual description, with a particular schema that defines some specific predicates or defines some specific things that are relations between subjects and objects. And so there's a list of terms and relations. These include class, property, type, subclass. There are several that are defined here, not really important for you to remember those in particular, although if you do want to get some more details and examples about RDF and how this all works, then you can take a look at this link here on your own time that we'll go into a little bit more detail on that. So the second term that I need to bring into the picture before we get to the semantic web is the term ontology. It turns out that this term is actually kind of used loosely in various contexts. In the context that I'm going to use it, this is high-level subject classification. So in much the same way that you have your list of terms, your controlled vocabulary, such as Library of Congress subject headings, or you have the Art and Architecture Thesaurus, or you may have heard some other terms about different kinds of subject classifications, synonym rings, and so on. The ontology is really usually put at the top of the list in terms of complexity, and it really is what exists in the world and how is it described. And so it's usually formally describes a knowledge domain. It's a way of talking about a specific area of knowledge. It can be broad if you want to know all there is to know about everything. That's sometimes called an upper ontology. Most ontologies are narrower than all about everything, so we might have an ontology that just describes pizza, and it tells us everything we need to know about pizza, all the different objects that comprise a pizza, how they're related, what their names are, and so on, and that would be an ontology. Now, of course, a web ontology, then, is an ontology of things that exist on the web. That's probably easy enough to figure out. And then we've developed several different languages that allow us to express ontologies about the web in particular, and these are there are several of them. I'm going to talk about OWL, which is a web ontology language. You might think it would be WOL, W-O-L, for web ontology language. They just decided that OWL was easier to say, and that's the only reason for it. But OWL is a particular language for creating web ontologies, and it turns out that OWL uses the RDF schema in order to do that. Now, at this point, it might be confusing you a little bit, and it really is simpler than you might think. So probably a demo is in order. So here, and this actually may look fairly complex, but it's not. Let me point out some of the different sections of this. This is an ontology of a pizza. This is going to tell us what a pizza is, what are the component parts of it, and so on. And this is being created in an ontology editor. This particular ontology editor is called Protégé, and Protégé is an ontology editor that can use the web ontology language to create this. And so all I did to create this, really, the top level in ontology is always a thing. The thing that we're going to describe is the pizza. We have a few different classes of objects. We have the pizza, of course. We have pizza base. Pizza is made out of a pizza base and a pizza topping. Pizza base might have a couple of classes, deep pan base and thin and crispy base. So those are a couple of different bases that you can have with pizza. As we go down here, you can see the different kinds of toppings, how are these described, and so on. And so this is just really a kind of a hierarchical view of a pizza. And it, we can take a look at the properties. Remember, we talked about the predicates, those things that relate subjects and objects. And so we have a few properties here. So we can say certain portions of the pizza have ingredient, pizza has a base, pizza has topping. So these are different properties. And we can also take a look at the visualization here. And the visualization now begins to put this in that RDF kind of context where you see the RDF graph. You can see that over here on the right. Here are the subjects, the predicates, the objects. You can see the chain as it goes through. We can scroll through this ontology and see how all these different things relate to each other. And so this is the visual representation and the kind of schematic hierarchical list of the ontology that we've got. And now let's take a look at what actually is all underneath that. What's underneath that is some standard XML. Looks pretty standard. We see that it's got some flags here that in fact this is RDF. And so this is our typical header. And as we go through the sections here, don't have any annotation properties, don't have data types, but we do have object properties. So here we describe a couple of our objects and what kind of properties they have. So we see that an object is pizza and pizza has base. There are some clarifications here that I won't go into. This happens to be a functional property and so on. But we can go through here and see the different kinds of objects and properties. Pizza has an ingredient. Pizza has a topping. So these are all statements that the ontology editor has created. And then as we go down here, we get to our classes. So we see that the American hot pizza is a named pizza. It has a topping. The topping might be pepperoni. It has a topping mozzarella. It has a topping tomato. It has a topping jalapeno. And we can go through this list and see all of the different statements that we've made. And so really, this entire program back here is just a way of illustrating what is in that RDF file, that XML file that's RDF and OWL. Now, one of the things that an ontology gets us is that because these are expressed as formal logic statements, we can apply some class reasoning to it. So if we go up here and we start the reasoner, this is going to go through and analyze all the statements in here that are made out of the RDF. And if there's anything in here that's inconsistent, then it can flag it. It can say, no, your logic is wrong. There's a problem with this here. And you can see down here that I've got an inconsistent topping I set up that actually has some properties that would not be possible in the context of this pizza. And so it's actually flagged this for us. And so this is the way that machines can look at statements like this. They can look at collections of statements. They can look at knowledge and begin to apply some logic and reasoning to it. And I think that's probably all we need to get at for this. But that gives you an idea of what the ontology is, how it relates to XML, and how it relates to RDF. So now let's talk about the semantic web. The semantic web is the use of ontologies, modeling languages, and so on to create a web of data. And if you think about the web as you normally might think about it. It's a collection of documents, and those documents are all human readable. And a lot of the specifications we talked about earlier in the lecture allow us as humans to find, analyze, and retrieve those documents. But now what we're really talking about is turning the web's collection of all this textual information, all this knowledge, and turning it into a standardized form of statements about the resources and about the knowledge that can be read by computers and applications. And you may have heard the term linked data or linked data movement. This is a movement within the semantic web to provide and describe methods that expose structured data for discovery by applications. So the semantic web is really a way of turning the web, not changing it. We still want the web to be readable to us as humans, but it also creates a web of data that machines can actually use and understand. Let me give you an example of a project that is making this happen right now. If you think about Wikipedia, Wikipedia is the human-readable corpus of information about the world and things in it, and so it's very useful for people. We look up, we find out what information is there. We use and consume that information. But a machine can't really look up, a computer application can't look something up in Wikipedia and make sense of it. So there's a crowdsource project going on now called DBpedia, which is Wikipedia expressed as an ontology. In other words, people are going in, they're taking these articles, they're taking all of the facts and knowledge and descriptions of the resources that are in Wikipedia and turning them into an ontology. So If you actually had a Wikipedia entry called pizza, the text might talk about pizza and pizza having ingredients and so on. And DBpedia then would actually be the expression of the ontology that we just looked at that puts all of that into a formal semantic kind of a language that computers can understand. So we can take a look at two examples here. Let's take a look at the Wikipedia page for Berlin. And of course, you're familiar with what this looks like. I probably didn't even need to go here. But you can see this has got a lot of facts in it. So one of 16 states of Germany, 3.5 million people, second most populous city. These are all kinds of statements or assertions that we can make about the content of this article and about the city of Berlin. And of course, this is of absolutely no use to a computer application, barring some experiments that are going on with artificial intelligence now, trying to figure out how to parse standard English. But this, in its current form, is not particularly useful for a computer application. So let's look at the DBpedia page. And the DBpedia page can be viewed. What it does is it takes the ontology and actually creates a somewhat human readable page, but you can see all the facts that are in here now, lists of facts. And what I'd like to do is actually view the page source, because I think that's going to be where you're going to see the XML and the OWL ontologies here. Okay, now you can see that we have our standard, and this is sort of a mix of HTML and XML. So you see that XHTML plus RDF is the version here. And we see the XML namespace declarations in addition to the HTML markup. And this is the header information. What I'm going to do, and there's a long list of these that are the abstracts that we saw earlier, but what I'd like to do is to get down to the actual facts themselves and show you what we're looking at. So if you look at the subject as Berlin, and we think about our RDF, we need a predicate, which is some kind of a property, and then we need a value for that property. So if the subject is Berlin, we have a predicate here, a property, DBpedia OWL. So again, this is an OWL ontology, and the particular property that we're looking for is total population. So this is our predicate. DBpedia OWL population total is our predicate. And then this is the XML namespace for DBpedia OWL. Remember, we mentioned namespacing earlier. And this is the location where this particular property comes from. And then we notice that the value for this property, this is the object, is the population total. So that should give you an idea of how this works, how we turn information that's human readable into information that's machine readable. Machines can come through, they can parse, that is, take apart all these particular things, and they can find these instances of the predicates or the properties and the subject, which is, of course, the Wikipedia page, and then extract all the values here. And this can now actually be used as part of a computer application. So that wraps up the lecture. That was a very, very high-level overview of the semantic web. I hope it gave you some idea of what's going on. It really is an important thing for information professionals, librarians, and so on to know about. We've looked at a couple of different things. Just to summarize, we saw how XML was used to organize resources for people to aid in discovery, evaluation, and access, and that allows people to find resources, read them, evaluate them. And then we also saw how XML and the semantic web was used to organize data for machines and applications to discover and analyze. And that's an important area for future research. If you're into knowledge organization and you're an information professional, then you need to know about those things. So I hope this was helpful. So thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed the lecture, got a lot out of it, and will find it useful as you make your careers in the information sciences. Thank you.